First and foremost, be open-minded. When you are a researcher, it's quite natural to think that your subject is the most important in the world. Well, let's face it, you wouldn't be a good researcher if you thought otherwise. But networking often means reaching out to people beyond your comfort zone and therefore beyond your area of expertise. For example, networking with top scholars in your own field will allow you to find new co-authors or individuals who you could one day consult to make a decision concerning one of your projects, or refer to on a committee for a grant, or be a contact for a new job, or even for getting tenure. In any case, knowing as many scholars as possible in your field is not only interesting, but also useful. And this is even more so as your career evolves. The broader and the more substantial your projects become, the more likely those committees will be composed of people beyond your own field. And over time, you might be willing to extend your own research beyond your comfort zone, therefore reaching out to people with a different knowledge-based expertise and/or network than yours will also allow you to establish a broader platform for the development of your own work. In my honest opinion, when reaching out to
business angels,
it's really important to face the fact that the business world is often more interested in what is useful. On the other hand, academics are usually more interested in what is true. Very often, the misunderstanding comes from the confusion that both parties think that truth and usefulness are the same thing. Okay, sure, that may be the case in the very long term, but in the short term, some concepts that are true may be, unfortunately, not applicable to the business world. And some scientific concepts may appear really useful, but frankly, are completely untrue. And before you even think about approaching
business angels,
you have to ask yourself, what is it they want? What do they fund? And why? There are several types with various investment profiles. But remember, they are in this business to make money. For example, let's say you want to fund your research in, say, mathematics in order to prove a spectacular new proof, but that has no foreseeable financial impact. Well, then don't go see a business angel. But don't get me wrong. Spectacular proofs should be funded. And fortunately, there are research agencies and even patron foundations who are more than willing to fund that amazing proof. But this is not funded by
business angels.
So in short, just like what Cécile Michaud spoke about in week one of this MOOC on knowing your audience, the same advice applies here. Know what your funders are looking for and apply there. Now, if you do capture the attention of
business angels,
well, congratulations. But it's really important to keep in mind that
business angels
will probably look closely at the technology readiness level, or TRL for short, of the project. They will heavily analyze the time leading up to the TRL, the probability the project succeeds, the possible revenues if it succeeds, and the potential lifespan of the project. So, be ready with this information. Once you've established a strong working relationships, communicate with them and do it often. In a situation where both parties do not share the same background and even objectives, communication is key. It is important that you regularly follow up on the expectations initially established. I'm convinced that collaborations between academia and the business world can be very fruitful. But doing so requires a lot more investment than one might initially think. And it takes practice. But once the journey starts, it is very interesting and sometimes even enjoyable for everyone involved. Essentially, networking can be boiled down to one key concept, and that is fostering connections in order to mobilize talented individuals. Networking is probably one of the most important aspects of my job. As the president of Telecom Paris, I am the leading spokesperson of the school, and therefore, I would say about one-third of my time should be dedicated to networking and presenting the school to the global community. And here, we can very quickly see the benefits of networking in our specific academic context. It is important that I convey what the school does or intends to do in the future and what it could bring to our multiple target audiences. This includes networking for attracting new students and faculty, for funding, for opening a new research department, or for any developmental project. And this principle is true for all of academia, but also for public and private organizations. At the end of the day, what is key is the value we can create by establishing such collaborations. For instance, we sign partnerships with other universities for double degrees. We've launched joint laboratories with companies willing to develop their R&D. And finally, we actively seek financing from the state and other public organizations in order to open new doors in research. I'm often the first contact when opening a dialogue with companies that may have an interest in establishing partnerships with our researchers, our teaching programs, or our students. I present the school's mission and goals for the future, and then I help put the right people in touch with the talented individuals we have at the school, and then the magic happens.